I'm Tamara, and this is TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. We're bringing together experts, thinkers, and leaders, busting myths, sharing stories, and staying connected when Canadians need it the most. We're having unexpected conversations for unprecedented times. Hi, everyone. Today we are talking with one of Canada's leading mental health experts and TELUS Chief Neuroscience Officer, Dr. Diane McIntosh. Hi, Diane. How are you?
I am well, Tamara. Thank you for having me back.
Oh, it's so nice to hear your voice and see your face. March 14th was the day that I last saw you, 3 months ago.
Time flies.
It really does. A lot has happened. In some ways, I feel like, you know, that was so long ago that we spoke. And in other ways, I feel like it was just yesterday. I don't really have a sense of time right now. But I want to know from you, in these 3 months since we've spoken, what are you hearing from people about, you know, their experience in isolation?
You know, Tamara, I've already had a sense that we are in something of a mental health crisis in this country. We were before the COVID crisis, and I am increasingly concerned about what the long-term sequelae of this experience is going to be. And it's not simply, I mean, it's enough, I think, that we already are very concerned about our health for ourselves and our loved ones. But also, I'm really concerned about the long-term economic impact that all of this is going to have on so many individuals. So people who are already vulnerable are more vulnerable, but even people who weren't so vulnerable given life circumstances, I think are really quite vulnerable now as well. So I would say I've gone from really concerned to super concerned about the mental health of fellow Canadians.
Mm-hmm. You know, it's when we see what's happening in the world right now, right? We are hyper aware of everything that's going on. I mean, there's more people watching the news now than ever before. We're all over social media, and there are some really horrible things happening in the world besides COVID. You know, and COVID is a horrible thing where, you know, thousands of people are dying. I think it was up to over 400,000 deaths now. We all kind of thought, you know, back in March that this would be maybe a couple of months. At least I did. I didn't realize that, you know, second wave and all this. How are people faring that are alone? You know, like it's one thing, we'll talk about families and difficult people and working and all of that sort of stuff, but isolation is lonely. And if you are alone through this, this is obviously not a good place for people who are maybe already have mental health challenges.
Yeah. I think when we think about how connected we are now, and certainly when I was young, we didn't have the internet. So we tend to think about ourselves as being so connected to everyone around us. Well, that's true. In the history of the world, we have never been more connected and never been more lonely. You throw on top of that the fact that people are physically distant. Sometimes the way that they were able to interact with others was through work, because we spend more time at work than anywhere else. That isolation for many people is really quite jarring, and I think highly impactful on people's mental health.
You know, I love my family, but being with them 24/7 for the last 3 months has had its set of challenges. We also know that a lot of people are working still and dealing with maybe difficult people they had to deal with at work. And now they're having to deal with, you know, these challenging relationships in a different way. Are you hearing this from people? Any, you know, difficult relationships?
Well, I think because people are quite frustrated, like you said, being at home all the time, feeling like you're glued to your chair, probably not keeping to their schedules, which, you know, I realize I sound like a broken record. Schedule, 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 making sure you get up at the same time, go to bed at the same time. But people fall off their normal routines. That means that they're probably a little more irritable, not sleeping quite as well as normal. So they're frustrated and frustrating, and that leads to more conflict. And especially when you're trying to work from home, you can't pick up social cues, right? Right now, you and I are able to look at each other so I can see your face. You're going, good answer, or maybe not so much. So I'm able to react to that, right? If we're not interacting that way, maybe trying to connect with people we don't know, that can lead to misunderstandings. Maybe we're trying to interact more on email. And if you've ever been sarcastic on email, you know that does not work. So there's a lot of openings here for misunderstandings, misinterpretations, conflict, and then we're tired and worried. So it's a toxic stew right now for a lot of people. As we open up, people are walking more, getting outside more. Hopefully that's going to improve things. But I think people are quite challenged interpersonally, both at home, work, and in grocery stores and everywhere else.
Mm-hmm. What are some things that we can do to make that, you know, I don't know, just make it easier on ourselves? Or do you have tips for people that are, you know, in situations where they're just, you know, maybe surrounded by people that don't have the same views as them and people that are, you know, just challenging?
Well, that's a huge question, but
yeah. I know. We have a little bit of time here.
How do we handle difficult people? Well, it's just like this. The way
I few books written on that, I think,
just
too.
A book or two. I think for me, the most important thing that I have learned to do is to say, hey, that's you, not me. I don't wear other people's stuff. I know myself, what I've brought to the conversation. I'm always willing to learn how I could do that a little bit better. So if someone shares with me, I don't like how you did that, I'm going to reflect on that. But if someone's really upset, really angry, and you're not sure why, don't own it. You can ask some questions. And I think if you own it, then you become emotional. If you don't own their thing, then you don't go down that road with them. You're able to stay a little bit back from it and look at it more critically and ask some probing questions gently. The other thing is, if someone's really upset or angry, speak a little more slowly. Make sure that you don't use a loud voice and that your voice doesn't match theirs, which sometimes, you know, the escalation with the voices going up. So speaking slowly, using shorter sentences, not in a way that the person feels condescended to, of course, but just saying, I'm not sure I understand. Can you tell me a little bit more about that? Short sentences, not big words, not confusing. Keep your voice low. And also physically, and we can do this right now, there we go. Mm-hmm. How do you relax yourself if you're in the chair and you're feeling, my jaw is getting tense, I can feel my shoulders going up? You can physically teach yourself how to physically relax, feel your backside in the chair, let your fingers kind of wiggle a little bit, try to relax your jaw, relax your neck. That actually, because your physical and your mental health are completely connected, when you physically relax, you also emotionally relax. So don't own it. Speak slowly, speak quietly, as quietly as you can. Don't use long sentences. Just try to be crisp and try to physically relax yourself.
You know, it's interesting when we're in this space of isolation, you know, you're alone, but if you're with your family, you actually aren't alone, right? If there's, you know, there's five of us in our house, lots of houses have more than that in it. You never seem to be alone. Especially if you're a parent, you're rarely alone. And it's hard. There's moments of, you know, I'm hearing this from so many people. There's moments of rage, you know, like you clean the house and 5 minutes later, it's a disaster and you seem to have to clean it again, or you're already, like you mentioned, feeling stress from financial stress or, you know, health stress, whatever you're worrying about. And our nerves seem raw, really raw. And, you know, we always hear from people, oh, you should meditate, and you should do this, and you should do that. The other thing I know that a lot of people are doing is drinking more. And I mean, I know this is, it's a short-term thing, right? Isn't it? You know what I mean? Like, I'm trying to understand from you, from a medical point of view, at what point do we, like, how long can we sustain this for? It's been 3 months. How much longer can we keep doing what we're doing before we really start to notice our mental health, you know, deteriorate?
Well, I wouldn't wait for this to be ended by a particular government or the situation to end. If you feel like you're going down a path that either you yourself or the people around you are saying, hey, I'm a little bit concerned. You got to address it now, because we don't know how long this is going to go on. And things like I talked about with the routine being very important, making sure you're getting up at the same time, going to bed at the same time. If you're working from home, keeping your office, if it's possible, separate from the rest of your life so you can close that off. I'm always very cautious in situations like this. I'm not telling anyone what to do, but I can tell you that nothing messes with your sleep quite like alcohol. Even though it can help you to get to sleep, it really messes up your sleep structure. So if you're finding you're drinking more, escalating amounts, so it used to be I was just having a small glass of wine at dinner and now I'm drinking half a bottle of wine or a whole bottle of wine, you're in a on a path that, despite what's going on the outside world, may continue to a place you don't want to go. And that could also be if you're smoking cannabis and you're finding you're using more, you can't sleep without it, you can't sleep without alcohol. Is it affecting your life and your functioning? You need to take that seriously. And if you catch it early enough to be able to say, you know what, I'm just not going to do it now. I'm going to stop myself from going there because my partner, my kids, whatever, have expressed some concerns, or you yourself know that you're concerned. The longer we let this go on and you get into these patterns of behavior, the harder it is to break those patterns.
Mm. What are some signs that, you know, we should look for within ourselves or the people closest to us to know that they might be struggling with something? Are there things you look for? Well, obviously there are things you look for. You're a doctor. This is what you do. But what could the average person do to see a sign?
If you're talking about signs that maybe your mental health is mm-hmm. not as strong mm-hmm. as it was, then, you know, I think a lot of us are experiencing anxiety. But anxiety becomes a problem. We all know what it, you know, I'm feeling anxious, I'm worried, I'm getting some stomach upset, I'm feeling a little shaky, those kinds of things. But those usually happen if you don't have a serious mental illness. They can happen in response to a particular event. I've got a big presentation to do or something. But if you're finding that you're experiencing those symptoms of worry or those signs of worry or feeling down most of the time, almost mm. every day, and that it's starting to affect your functioning. And by that, I mean your ability to parent, your ability to do your job, your ability to get along with other people. If you find you're increasingly isolated, I'm less interested in contacting people that I was in contact with a lot before. If you're sleeping more than usual, not loss of sleep, you can have, I can't sleep at all, or I want to sleep all the time. I'm eating way too much, or I'm not eating very much at all, and I'm not hungry. Those changes in your normal biorhythms can be a suggestion that maybe your mental health is not what it was. The functioning is really important. Listen to the people around you, the people you love, who, if someone says to you, you just don't seem yourself, you seem to be a lot more irritable, you're quicker to get upset about things, or you seem sad or down, listen to them and have a frank conversation. What do you mean about that? Sometimes people will get offended. And, you know, why would you say that? If someone's saying that to you, it's usually because they're worried and they care.
If somebody is feeling they need to, I mean, this is the other, you know, getting into a psychologist or a psychiatrist or a therapist of some sort is very difficult at the best of times, never mind when there's a worldwide pandemic and we're all, you know, being told to stay home. I know that we're starting to, you know, open things up and all that, but I mean, where does somebody even begin to, a lot of people don't know where to look. So many Canadians don't even have, you know, a family doctor that they could ask. So do you have any suggestions on how somebody could find some help?
Absolutely. So first of all, the most important thing for anyone who's listening to know is you are not alone. One in every five Canadians will have a mental illness. So either you have one yourself or you love someone who has a mental illness. So you are not alone, and it's okay not to be okay. What's not okay is not to do anything about it, because you owe it to yourself and the people who love you to try to be your best self every day. And that means reaching out for help. There is no shame in that. The best place to start is with your family doctor if you have one. If you don't have a family doctor or you don't have that connection, you've tried before and they don't seem to listen, then going to a walk-in clinic or using one of the virtual care platforms. So we have Akira, we have Babylon. For most TELUS employees, this is free. For many Canadians across the country, they have access to these healthcare platforms and they will offer help, support, and a plan going forward. Not everyone who has a mental illness requires medication. As you mentioned, Tamara, talk therapy can be extremely valuable, cognitive behavioral therapy, for instance, but sometimes you just need more activity. Exercise is a treatment for depression, and you don't need to do a lot, 30 minutes a day of a brisk walk. So there are many approaches, but the most important thing is to get support, ask the question of someone, a family practitioner, a nurse practitioner who knows what they're doing, and find out, you know, how serious is this and what are my next steps?
Mm-hmm. And I'm sure we could talk about this next question for hours, but I'm gonna ask you anyways. Kids, I find it really hard. You know, this is, I've never been a parent before. You know, you're a parent with, you know, that's your first time being a parent. And I feel like a lot of times you're learning as you go and you're trying to navigate so many things and, you know, compare notes with your friends about how your kids are doing. How do we know that there's a lot going on in the world for our kids to understand? How do we make sure that their mental health is, you know, is thriving, it's good, it's healthy, it's, they're okay?
Yeah, they don't come with instruction books, unfortunately. Mm. And I've been doing it, I think, a little longer than you. So my kids are 18 and 23. I think yours are a little bit younger than that.
But yeah,
it's always a challenge and you worry as a parent, and that's never going to change. The most critical thing to do to protect your children is to love them, to provide a non-chaotic environment as much as possible. So, you know, people sometimes when they're in the midst of a difficult divorce, for instance, pulling their kids into this is a disaster for kids. They need to have a non-chaotic, loving, nurturing environment that is safe. That is the best thing you can do for your kids. Even if you have a mental illness, people often worry, I'm going to pass it on to my kid. The best way to protect a child is to make sure they have a loving, nurturing, non-chaotic environment. When most kids present with a mental illness is during their teen years. When it becomes obvious is during their teen years. Sometimes it can be earlier, and certainly ADHD can be an early, or much earlier onset. But most serious mental illnesses start during those teen years. The best way that I know to have that sort of monitoring of their mental health is to talk to them. I stopped years ago asking my kids, how was your day? Because what is the answer? Fine.
Yeah.
I asked them, what did you do today? Tell me about your day. And after a while, they started seeking me out when they got home to have that conversation with me because they wanted to tell me. And now they tell me more than I want to know. So engaging your kids from the time they're really young. And when you do engage them, listen. And I know right now, many parents across the land want to strangle their children because they've been alone with them nonstop for 3 months at a time. And you just want to get, but that important time of when you're engaged with them, full on brain, okay, I'm turning everything, my phone, everything. Yeah. I'm with you right now. Tell me what's going on. I want to hear all about it. That is the way that you're, when things are going off the rails, your kids share with you.
Mm-hmm. And how are you doing in this? I mean, I would think that as a psychiatrist in a time where we're, you know, the world, this year has been, I mean, we're 6 months into this year and it's not been great for anyone. How are you doing? Like, there's a lot for you because you hear other people struggle so much. So I'm wondering, how does that come into play for your own mental health?
Well, I would say that my family life has been the most sustaining part for me of my life is that, you know, we've always had these very loud and quite forward dinner time conversations. And now they're a little later, they last a little longer, and maybe they're a little louder. But I think that that has kept me well. I can't even explain why I don't ever wear other people's stuff. And I've gotten better as I've gotten older. So I've been a psychiatrist for more than 20 years now. And I recognize if I am pulled into this with you, then I'm no help. So I do keep my distance there, because that way I can be sort of the outside sober second thought. So I can't get pulled into that. Doesn't mean I don't get pulled into my kid stuff, because I can be a mama bear just like anyone else. But I do find that having that time with my family where we're having these challenging conversations, it's, you know, I've treated PTSD for most of my career. And what I learned from that experience was that out of the most horrible things, good things do come. And I believe that. And I think that we've had one punch in the gut after another over the last little while, and the horrors of the racism that are coming to the fore right now. I think, I mean, it's horrific, but I see it as an incredible opportunity to create change. It exists here. It exists everywhere. How do we help to make a difference in the way that our communities treat people of color? It has to change. And so I see this as an opportunity out of a horrible, horrible situation, especially for family members that are involved. So I think that it's been a rough many months, but it also is an opportunity to pull together as a community and to make some important social changes.
It is, conversations are always, for the most part, I think conversations are a great way to sort of, you know, work through many things. One thing I've noticed during this time is that there are some people whose opinions I really don't agree with. Like, I have strong reactions to people I know. And, you know, we may have a conversation about Black Lives Matter, and I don't agree with their view. Or, you know, people that don't believe that COVID is an actual pandemic, you know, all these different views in mine, and or anybody else's, really. I'm not the only one it's hard to not, I know you say to not take it on. It's hard to not take it on when you feel so passionate about the right thing. Do you know what I'm trying
totally.
To say here?
Totally. Been there, done that.
Yeah. So, I mean, I loved what you said about not taking it on, because that's my husband's reaction to me is always not your problem. You know, when I start like getting into a fight with somebody about something. Diane, don't think that I am just a fighter and that's all I'm not saying that. I'm just giving you an example of, you know, these conversations, and we all have them with people. We all have people in our lives that we don't agree with. I don't want to be the person that, you know, doesn't take it on because, you know, it's not my problem. I sometimes want the problem, you know, I want to make the point so that you know what I'm saying. So
totally.
Doctor, what do we do about this?
There are battles you can win, and there are battles that you will never win. And I don't mean, because I think we all have to be part of this solution. We all have to raise our voices, but we are stronger as one. So you can sit down every racist and every, you know, bad guy and every terrible person out there who doesn't believe in this, that, or every conspiracy theorist and tell them till you're blue in the face. You are not going to change that one person. Mm-hmm. We have to change the world here. And to do that, we have to speak with a big voice, with many people. And you know what? We got to vote. People have to vote. This is the way that things will change, is by expressing yourself, not through violence, but expressing yourself at the ballot box and by speaking loudly with one voice. But I decided a long time ago with the various family members I have that are conspiracy theorists, for instance, I got all the science in the world, but they're not interested. So there are some people I'm not going to change that way. And so I'm not going to battle there, but I am going to stand up for what I believe is right. That's why I write. That's why we have these conversations. We have a big voice that we can create together. That to me is a way to change the world, because one-on-one with some of these people that aren't believers, you're not going to change that person, but we can change the world when we speak together.
I love that. Yes. I love that. That is, I am going to, I'm going to take a clip of that sentence of yours and keep replaying it. You're right. You're absolutely right. And you probably walk away feeling a lot better about, you know what I mean? About what it is you're trying to do if you just don't engage with the person you're not going to change. Any tips for us, Diane, as we move forward into these, you know, these uncertain times?
Serenity now. I don't know. That was a Seinfeld. You know, I think taking care of each other right now, yeah. You know, it's people are isolated. If you know that someone isn't very connected, you're not hearing from them as much, they are not seeming themselves, don't be afraid to reach out. And as a friend, they may just want you to be their friend, but it's compassion is always in vogue. It's always something right. to show, you know, to say, can I do anything? Are you okay? Without judgment, if there's anything you need from me, and it may be, I just need you to be my friend, okie doke, I'm here for you. Or I need you to help me make an appointment, or I need you to take care of my kids so that I can go and breathe somewhere. Whatever it is that there's, I guess I encourage people rather than being silent again to say, I'm here if you need me. What do you need? And it may not be what you expect. If it's $1 million, then maybe have another discussion. But if it's just, I need a little bit of help, or I just need you to be my friend, that's okay. Mm-hmm. You've expressed concern.
Yeah. Great advice. Really, really good talking to you. I hope that we talk again. And I hope that when we talk again, we're, you know, I hope that
on the other side of this.
Yeah, I really hope we're on the other side of a lot of this. I really do. But great advice as always. And I really appreciate you taking the time. I know you're very busy. So thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
It was my pleasure.
Yes. And Dr. McIntosh can be found on her website, Doctor, that's a D-O-C-T-O-R, spelled out, Diane McIntosh, MCINTOSH.com. And be sure to join us here on TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart every week.